Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 12th April 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in both Chennai and Delhi edition of the newspaper. The first discussion of the day is based on three articles of the newspaper which focuses on the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. These articles appeared on page number 9, 10, 11 of the Chennai edition and page 7, 8, 9 of the Delhi edition. Now, the various aspects of this news article come under current events of national importance and history of India and Indian national movement in preliminary examination syllabus, and the freedom struggle, its various stages and important contributors, contributions from different parts of the country in GS1 paper. Let us now get into the main discussion about the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. Let us know about the background for this massacre. See, the government of India passed the Rowlatt Act in March 1919. The act authorized the British Indian government to imprison any person without trial and conviction in a court of law, and it aimed at severely curtailing the civil liberties of Indians in the name of curbing revolutionary violence. The act would thus also enable the government to suspend the right of habeas corpus, which had been the foundation of civil liberties in Britain. This act was passed even though every single Indian member of the Central Legislative Council opposed it, and it was treated by the whole of political India as a grievous insult because it came as a sudden blow to the people of India, who were promised the extension of democracy and substantial constitutional concessions during the World War I. Hence, this step of the government appeared to be a cruel joke, and it spread agitation across the country, during which Gandhiji stepped in and took the command of the national movement, and he suggested that a new technique of struggle by the name Satyagraha be launched on 6th of April 1919. And a nationwide hartal, which means a strike that was accompanied by fasting and prayer, was decided as the form of protest. But the movement which emerged was very different from the one anticipated, because the protest was accompanied by violence and disorder in many areas. Events in Punjab were moving particularly in a tragic direction, and the arrest of two leaders, Dr. Saifuddin Kichlu and Dr. Satyapal, led to attack by people of Punjab on the town hall and the post office, and the telegraph wires were cut, and Europeans, including women, were attacked. As a result of this, army was called in and the city was handed over to General Dyer, who was the British military commander of Amritsar, and he issued an order prohibiting public meeting and assemblies. All the above events led to the day of 13th April, a Baisakhi day, when a large unarmed crowd of people, many of whom were visitors from the neighboring village who came for the celebration, gathered in the Jallianwala garden to attend a public meeting. See, the General Dyer was enraged that his orders were disobeyed, so he surrendered the bagh, or the garden, with his army unit, closed the exit with his troops, and then ordered his men to shoot into the trapped crowd with rifles and machine guns. He had not thought to issue any warnings, nor did he give any opportunity to disperse, even though the garden was closed on three sides with high walls, which left little chance or no chance for the crowd to escape. The shooting continued for 10 to 15 minutes until their ammunition were exhausted. After this tragic incident, the British Indian government estimated the death toll to be 379, which was a gross underestimation, while the other institutions estimated a higher death toll. After all this, the repression was intensified in Punjab with martial law, and people were submitted to the most uncivilized and undignified atrocities, such as flogging of people in public, arrest and detention of Indian students and professors, construction of an open cage for confinement of arrested Indians, and a crawling order which forced the people of India to crawl on their bellies before Europeans, and depriving of basic amenities by the cutting of electric and water supplies. Even though this led to the withdrawal of Rowlatt Satyagraha by Gandhiji, it removed the illusions about the benign and benevolent British rule, and it finally culminated to a liberation struggle led by Gandhi, that is, the non-cooperation movement, and Rabindranath Tagore renounced his knighthood as a protest to the tragedy. After the massacre, an investigation committee was set up, which was the Disorders Inquiry Committee, also known as the Hunter Committee, as the name of chairman was Hunter. In his testimony, Dyer asserted that his intention had been to punish the crowd, to make a wide impression and to strike terror not only in Amritsar but throughout Punjab. The committee split along racial lines and submitted a majority and minority report. The majority report of the Hunter Committee used criticism tactically, established Dyer's culpability, but the Lieutenant Governor Michael O'Dayer was made to walk free. The minority report written by the three Indian members were more scathing or more severe in its criticism. By then, Dyer had become a liability for British colonial government and he was asked to resign his command from India. This decision of letting off Dyer without punishment was approved by the British Secretary of State, Edwin Montagu, and by the House of Commons. The Conservative Lords, however, took a different track and rebuked the government for being unjust to the officer Dyer. They were against letting off Dyer from his charge in India. Similar sentiments in Dyer's favor came from the right-wing press, The Morning Post, which started a fund for Dyer and it collected £30,000, and also from conservative sections of the public who believed Dyer had saved India for the British Empire. Rudyard Kipling, who had contributed £10 to the fund, put a mixed comment on the wreath he sent to Dyer's funeral in 1927. The wreath said, "He did his duty as he saw it." See, the Winston Churchill called Dyer's deed in Jallianwala Bagh as an extraordinary event, a monstrous event, an event which stands in sinister isolation. Privately, Churchill also wrote that the offense amounted to murder or alternatively manslaughter. Significantly, Churchill compared the event to Prussian tactics of terrorism, said that the massacre was not the British way of doing things. In other words, he was resorting to British exceptionalism. To save the larger colonial enterprise as benign, he stated Dyer as a rogue or animal-like officer. The present Queen of England has termed it as a distressing example of history. The then Prime Minister David Cameron quoted the Dyer as monstrous, similar to Churchill, adding that it was a deeply shameful event in British history. They just said all these things but never said an apology. In the editorial article, the author criticizes that the British Prime Minister Theresa May, similar to her predecessors, referring to the Jallianwala Bagh massacre, saying, "We deeply regret what happened and the suffering caused." There were some expectation of a British apology on the occasion of the centenary of the horrific Jallianwala Bagh massacre. But this time, the demand came not just from Indians alone, but also from a strong contingent of British Member of Parliaments across political parties. He condemns the statement by saying, "The words are important, especially in the heavily nuanced English language, and those who invented that language certainly knows how to use them." One can imagine the careful drafting in Whitehall that would have gone into formulating the Prime Minister's statement. The second aspect of the statement that stands out is its passiveness. What happened? The suffering caused. The words never mentioned who did this heinous massacre, and the statements were just passive. In another article, the author tries to explain why some tragedies are not forgotten by public like the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. He lists some massacres in the history, like the killing of every male inhabitant of the Persian town of Kernan in 1794 by Aga Mohammed Khan. These works are also reminders of what the powerful, if given a chance, will inflict on the weak. In this line, a documentary has been directed that throws light on Jallianwala Bagh massacre on the 100th anniversary of the massacre to pay homage to the hundreds gunned down by General Dyer's troops on April 13, 1919. The documentary is named as Jallianwala Bagh Oru Orma Padathal. With this, we conclude this topic. The prelims and mains questions displayed here will be discussed later at the last session of this video. This news article appears on page number 13 in Chennai edition and page number 11 in Delhi edition of the newspaper. The article is about fake news and misinformation, particularly at the time of election. The information given thus becomes part of current events of national importance and Indian polity under the preliminary examination syllabus, and the points could be used in writing essay in paper 1 and under salient features of Representation of People's Act in GS2 and under role of media and social networking sites in internal security challenges in GS3 of the mains examination. Now, the volume of fake news spread through social media platforms is massive. During the period of 12 months from October 2017 to September 2018, Facebook has identified 250 crore accounts globally as fake accounts and has removed them. The issue of fake news is a threat to free and fair elections as it influences the voting mindset and it alters the voting patterns, thus the danger of people making their choice by voting based on fake news. But actually, it should be based on reliable and authentic information based on which people should exercise franchises. And this access to reliable information is a component of free and fair elections, which is the foundation of democracy. The article also discusses few steps taken by Facebook on its own to help ensure that the Lok Sabha election was free from interference, both foreign and domestic. The platform is said to have followed international norms of fact-checking to ensure credibility of checking the authenticity of content on its platforms in India. Steps such as blocking and removing fake accounts, fighting the spread of misinformation, stopping abuse of Facebook platform by domestic actors, spotting attempts at foreign meddling and acting against inauthentic coordinated campaigns, these were some of the steps that were taken by Facebook. It is stated that the existing legal provisions in regulating the social media platforms, considering their vulnerabilities in being used for spreading these fake news and how exactly these legal provisions could be used, is still not clear, and these provisions are less than adequate. We have Section 126 of Representation of the People Act 1951, which prohibits propagating election matters to the public through a musical concert or any theatrical performance or any other entertainment or amusement or a public meeting during the prohibitory period of 48 hours before completion of poll. Now, this section, Section 126, was enacted in the year 1996. At that time, the problem of fake news did not surface. Moreover, the Chief Election Commissioner has stated that the Section 126 is not applicable to the print media and particularly to the social media. Another issue is that the logistic challenges associated with the regulation. Hundreds of monitoring committees spread across the country may not be enough to identify and verify the news that come every single second in social media. Hence, India should consider taking Germany as exemplar in this matter, as in Germany, it is the responsibility of the social media platform to remove the violating content when such content is posted by individuals. The Bombay High Court recently asked the social media platforms to follow the Voluntary Code of Ethics for General Elections 2019 of the Internet and Mobile Association of India. Various social media platforms and the Internet and Mobile Association of India has presented this code to the Chief Election Commissioner in the month of March 2019. The document is a set of commitments by the social media platforms who agreed to process any violation reported under Section 126 within 3 hours as per Sinha Committee recommendations. This committee is also called as Committee on Section 126 of Representation of People Act 1951, for which Senior Deputy Election Commissioner was the chairman. Now, this committee was asked to study and examine, to identify difficulties and critical gaps, to suggest necessary amendments, with special reference to Section 126 and the prohibitory period of 48 hours before the completion of the poll. It was also to examine the type of communication technology or media platform and difficulties in regulating these media platforms and the impact of new media platforms when prohibitory period of 48 hours is in force. Also, to examine model code of conduct associated with the said issues and to suggest changes. See, the committee presented its report in the month of January 2019. Finally, there is also another issue, which is in the name of controlling fake news and misinformation, the extent of control should not violate the right to freedom of speech and the right to campaign in social media. Now, the displayed mains question will be discussed in the last part of this analysis in the video. With this, let's move on to the next article. The next article talks about the controversy on the legality of the electoral bond scheme. See, various aspects discussed in this news article come under current events of national and international importance and Indian polity and governance in prelims and Indian constitution, salient features of Representation of People Act, government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and issues arising out of their design and implementation and important aspects of governance, transparency and accountability in your main syllabus. Now, the government has argued that voters need not know from where political parties get their funds. The Attorney General added that the court cannot kill the electoral bond scheme for the sake of transparency. He argued that the bond was an experiment to eradicate black money and the court should not intervene now, which is in total contrast to the stand of Election Commission of India. The Attorney General, who spoke in favor of electoral bonds, added that transparency cannot be used as a mantra and elections are being fueled by black money, which is democracy's greatest evil. The Supreme Court bench added that merely knowing know your customer information would not block the entry of black money into political funding. KYC only covers the identity of the bond purchaser and would not be able to tell whether the money the purchaser used to buy the electoral bond was black or white. Further, they said black money could be converted to white by routing it through multiple shell companies. The stand of the Election Commission of India and a clear-cut explanation of the electoral bond scheme has been already covered in our daily news analysis and current affairs video on 11th April 2019 by our colleague Mr. Shanmugam, which has been posted by our Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel. You are requested to take a look at it. With this, let's move on to the next article. This article appears on page number 11 in Chennai edition and page number 9 in Delhi edition of the newspaper. The information given under this article is relevant under subtopic general science and also under current events of national and international importance under preliminary examination syllabus and also achievements of Indians in science and technology, indigenization of technology and developing new technology and awareness in the field of space for this General Studies 3 main syllabus. The news article is an interview with experts in the field of space. It highlights the importance of anti-satellite missiles and whether it can be seen as a game changer in global space governance. In this context, let us first understand the basics about ASAT missiles and current space laws. The ASAT missiles are space weapons designed to incapacitate or destroy satellites for strategic military purposes. ASAT missiles are of two types, kinetic and non-kinetic. A kinetic ASAT missile physically strikes an object and destroys it like ballistic missile. On the other hand, a non-kinetic ASAT uses non-physical means to disable a space object, such as use of frequency jamming to incapacitate satellites. An ASAT has three uses. Firstly, it can intercept, jam communication or military satellites of enemy countries. Secondly, it can access critical information about troop movements or incoming missiles. Lastly, it can launch cyber attacks on space systems and direct laser-based weapons. Recently, India has successfully test-fired an anti-satellite missile by shooting down a live satellite in the low Earth orbit under the project named as Mission Shakti. Mission Shakti was led by Defence Research and Development Organisation and is aimed at strengthening India's overall security. Thus, it's an indigenous development of the ASAT technology and this will have many spin-offs that India can exploit for civilian commercial use. India thus became the fourth nation in the world to test an ASAT weapon after United States, Russia and China. Israel is said to be on the path of developing its ASAT technology. Now, the intent of Mission Shakti is to defend India's space assets and not to start an arms race in space. Thus, ASAT test was not directed against any country, but as an added advantage, the capability achieved through the anti-satellite missile test provides credible deterrence against threats to our growing space assets. Also, Mission Shakti does not violate any international space treaty. Let us now move forward to understand how outer space is governed globally. The most important international treaty in this context is Outer Space Treaty. It forms the basis of international space law. It was signed in the year 1967 and is effective since then. It has 108 parties at present, in which India is also a party. The treaty bars or prohibits state parties from placing weapons of mass destruction in Earth orbit or installing them on Moon or any other celestial body or stationing them in outer space. See, a weapon of mass destruction is defined as either a nuclear or radiological or a chemical or a biological or any other weapon that can cause a great damage to humans and biosphere. But the treaty does not prohibit the placement of conventional weapons in the orbit. This is the reason why we can say that India has not violated the Outer Space Treaty, as ASAT is only a conventional weapon. The treaty also exclusively limits the use of Moon and other celestial bodies to peaceful purposes. It also focuses on protecting the space assets as everyday activities, from telecommunication to financial markets, civilian navigation, rely heavily on space infrastructure. Now, coming back to the news article, it highlights the need to shape up the global governance with the coming of ASAT missiles. Firstly, there is a visible weaponization of space. Secondly, China has shown much greater space competitiveness and leads in space activities. For the long time, India was just doing 4 to 5 launches per year. On the other hand, Chinese were doing 20 launches per year. While India has barely begun development of ASAT missiles, China has been at this for more than a decade. They are believed to have worked on missiles targeting high altitude satellites at 36,000 km above the Earth, whereas we have only conducted the test at the low Earth orbit. China has also been doing considerable work experimenting with laser-based weaponry and cyber weaponry, which are likely to prove to be more effective than a whole battery of missiles targeting satellites. While India has maintained a position of no weaponization of space, but now there is a steady accrual of military assets in space. This might signal a contradiction, and there is a need of domestic doctrine on weaponization of space on the lines of no first use policy for nuclear weapons. Now that India has demonstrated ASAT capability, India needs to play an even more active role in the global governance of outer space. We can certainly partner with like-minded countries in this regard. The displayed mains practice question will be discussed at the end of the analysis. With this, let's move on to the next article. Now, this article appears on page number 15 in Chennai and in page number 13 in Delhi edition of the newspaper. The information given under this article is relevant under the subtopic Economic and Social Development and Current Events of National and International Importance under the Preliminary Examination Syllabus, and in Indian Economy and Effects of Liberalization on the Economy, Changes in Industrial Policy and Their Effects on Industrial Growth in GS Paper 3. Coming to the news article, RBI reduced the repo rate by 25 basis points in February and recently in April. Now the repo rate is 6.25%. Rating agency Moody noted that the recent interest rate cuts by the Reserve Bank of India will help offset rising funding costs for financial services such as loans and prevent further mortgage rate rises this year. Mortgaging is the process of borrowing money to buy a house. Before understanding how repo rate affects the mortgage rates, let us know about few economic terms that will enable our understanding. Firstly, what is repo rate? See, the repo rate is also called as repurchase rate. It is the rate at which RBI lends to banks. This is done by RBI buying government bonds from banks with an agreement to sell them back at a fixed rate. Repo rate is a short-term measure, as it is being changed according to the needed circumstances in the economy. See, the objective of repo rate is to inject liquidity in the system. If RBI wants to make it more expensive for banks to borrow money, it increases the repo rate. Similarly, if it wants to make it cheaper for banks to borrow money, it reduces the repo rate. Next, let us know about MCLR. See, the MCLR stands for the marginal cost of funds based lending rate. The MCLR methodology for fixing interest rates for advances was introduced by RBI from 2016. These advances could be advances for house loans, car loans, etc. This new methodology replaced the base rate system introduced in July 2010. See, MCLR is the rate below which a bank cannot lend except in some cases allowed by the RBI. It is an internal benchmark, means a reference rate determined internally by the bank. This has been mainly introduced to improve the monetary transmission, which was not effective in the base rate system. See, the base rate calculation is based on cost of funds, whereas MCLR is based on marginal cost of funds. Therefore, MCLR is largely determined by marginal cost of funds and especially by deposit rates and repo rates. Now, coming back to the article, let us understand how repo influences the mortgage rates. With the central bank lowering the repo rate, it is likely that banks will also follow suit and reduce their marginal cost of funds based lending rates, that is MCLR. As house loans rate or mortgage rate is indexed to this MCLR, the transmission of this rate cut should reduce the borrowing cost of retail borrowers, MSMEs and corporates, thereby boosting private consumption and housing demand. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the analysis. With this, let's move on to the next article. Now, the next news article discusses about the solar e-waste threat posed at India, which appeared on page number 9 in Chennai edition and page number 7 of the Delhi edition. Now, the various information of this news article could come under current events of national importance and general science in prelim syllabus, and in mains it could come under GS3 in environmental pollution. See, India faces a major solar e-waste threat as it plans to tap the sun in a big way using photovoltaic cells to generate electricity. The news article says that it is a threat because India does not have a proper solar waste management. And a recent study by Bridge to India, an energy consultancy firm, that has estimated that India's photovoltaic waste volume by 2030 will be 2 lakh tons, and by 2050 it will be 1.8 million tons. Because though India has e-waste rules, those rules does not have any mandate for the disposal or recycle of waste from the solar cell manufacturers. And also, despite the e-waste regulation being in place for over 7 years, only less than 4% of estimated e-waste is recycled in the organized sector as per the estimates from Central Pollution Control Board. Moreover, India is among the leading markets for solar cells in the world, guided by the government's commitment to install 100 gigawatt of solar power by 2022. So far, India has installed solar cells for about 28 gigawatt, and this is largely from imported solar photovoltaic cells. And India's domestic manufacturers are largely involved in assembling cells and modules. These solar cell modules are made by processing sand to make silicon, by casting silicon ingots and using wafers to create cells, and then assembling them to make the solar cell modules. According to the Bridge to India study, 80% of these modules are non-hazardous materials such as glass and aluminium, and the remaining 20% are potentially hazardous such as polymers, metals, metallic compounds and alloys. Let us know what solar e-waste is. It is nothing but the photovoltaic cells, herein we discuss, that have reached their life cycle and haven't been recycled. They contain potentially hazardous chromium, cadmium, selenium, silicon tetrachloride and sulfur hexafluoride. With this, let's move on to the next article. Now, this news article appears in page number 9 of Chennai edition and page number 7 of Delhi edition newspaper. See, the information covered in this article comes under current events of national importance in prelims and under conservation and environmental pollution in GS3. See, the Supreme Court has asked the central government to approve composition of green crackers after the Petroleum and Explosive Safety Organization approves the new formulation of green crackers. The court allowed the manufacturers to apply for approval. See, once the approval is granted, the manufacturers may start the manufacturing of green crackers. In this context, let us know about green crackers and the Petroleum and Explosive Safety Organization. Coming to green crackers, see, the green crackers are those crackers that are less dangerous and less harmful to the environment and living beings, as they have less harmful chemicals that produce comparable lower emissions with respect to the conventional crackers. They are also having the capability of less particulate matter and less sulfur dioxide and nitrous oxide pollution. These crackers are called as green crackers because they have a chemical formulation that produces water molecules with or without air that reduces emission levels and absorbs the dust. Thus, they are environment friendly, and it is expected that these green crackers might be cheaper than conventional crackers by around 15 to 20%. Now, coming to Petroleum and Explosive Safety Organization. See, the organization was instituted in 1898 as a statutory authority which was entrusted responsibilities under Explosives Act 1884, Petroleum Act 1934, Inflammable Substance Act of 1952, and Environment Protection Act of 1986. The present purpose of this organization is to look after safety requirements in manufacturing, storage, transport and use of explosives and petroleum. Now it comes under Department of Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. It is headquartered in Nagpur. One special information related to this is that it has a fireworks research and development center at Sivagasi in the state of Tamil Nadu. The practice prelims question will be discussed in the last session of this video. With this, let's move on to the next article. Now, this article appears on page number 20 in Chennai edition and page number 18 in Delhi edition of the newspaper. The information given under this article is relevant under subtopic General Science and Current Events of National and International Importance under Preliminary Examination Syllabus. Coming to the news article, scientists have been using genetics to study wild animals for several years. However, a new genetic method has been developed by a team that includes scientists from National Center for Biological Sciences of Bengaluru. The team hopes to study and conserve wildlife by deriving information from animal sources that contain extremely low quality DNA, for example, including feces and cooked meat. Now let us see the new method that was developed by them. Their method relies on identifying multiple short portions of DNA segments in a single experiment, that is a multiplex PCR. Now, PCR stands for polymerase chain reaction. A multiplex PCR refers to use of polymerase chain reaction to amplify several different DNA sequences simultaneously. By targeting multiple sequences at once, additional information may be gained from a single test run that would otherwise require using reagents several times and thus taking more time to perform. And this new method also uses next generation sequencing, in which multiple fragments of DNA can be decoded simultaneously. Now, this method holds significance in the field of conservation efforts. Firstly, it can use a low quality DNA for information, thus relying on an easier source. Secondly, it can be used for animal monitoring and gathering intelligence on wildlife trade. Thirdly, it is cost effective, and the biggest advantage of this method is that it would take just 5 days, while older methods take at least a month. Thus, it becomes an easier and faster conservation method, and on the whole, it revolutionizes the conservation efforts. Next, let's move on to the revision come practice question session. We are in our last part of our video, and first we'll discuss a question with respect to Jallianwala Bagh massacre. They have given 4 statements and are asking which of the above statement is or are correct. The first statement: an unarmed crowd had gathered to protest at Jallianwala Bagh on 13th April 1919. The first statement is correct because the crowd had gathered to protest against the arrest of their leaders. Now, the second statement: the protest was against the arrest of leaders Bhagat Singh and Dr. Satyapal. Now, the second statement is wrong because the protest was against the arrest of leaders Saifuddin Kichlu and Dr. Satyapal. It was not Bhagat Singh. Therefore, the second statement is wrong. And the third statement: General Dyer, the military commander of Amritsar, ordered his troops to fire upon the crowd, which is correct. And the fourth statement: the Viceroy of India during this event was Chelmsford. We should know that Chelmsford was the Viceroy of India between the years 1916 to 1921. This massacre happened in the year 1919. So the fourth statement is correct. We find that only statement number 2 is wrong. The option A consists of this statement, option C consists of the statement number 2, Option D consists of the statement number 2. So A, C, D can be easily eliminated if we at least know the statement number 2 is wrong. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 1, 3 and 4 only. With this, let's move on to the next question. Now the next question is with respect to MCLR. Now they have given two statements and are asking which of the statements are correct. First statement, MCLR replaced the base rate system in 2016. See, the statement is correct and it is direct and is factual in nature. And second question, it is an external benchmark rate that improves monetary transmission. We saw that this MCLR improves monetary transmission, but it is not an benchmark rate. Rather, it is an internal benchmark rate because it is determined by a bank itself. Therefore, the second statement is wrong. Only the first statement is correct. The answer is A, 1 only. Now let us have a look at the third question. The third question is with respect to hazardous solar e-waste. Which of the following are classified as hazardous solar e-waste? They are asking correct options. Today we discussed that the solar cell modules are having 80% of the materials as non-hazardous, such as glass and aluminium, and remaining 20% are potentially hazardous, such as polymers, metal, metallic compounds and alloys, particularly chromium, cadmium, selenium, silicon tetrachloride and sulfur hexafluoride. Therefore, the aluminium is not a hazardous solar e-waste according to the today's discussion. Therefore, the correct option for this is option C, 1, 2, 3, 5 and 6 only. Now, the question number 5 reads as National Center for Biological Sciences, which is sometimes seen in the news. Yes, they are giving four options. And A, a non-governmental organization working in the field on environmental conservation. B, a research center under Department of Atomic Energy. C, a technical institution under Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. D, none of the above. See, it is a factual question. As all the options look close, we might get confused. But NCBC, see, the National Center for Biological Sciences is a research center under Tata Institute of Fundamental Research and is specialized in biological research. As Tata Institute of Fundamental Research falls under Department of Atomic Energy, NCBC also falls under it only. Option B, 2 only, is the correct answer. Therefore, National Center for Biological Sciences is a research center under Department of Atomic Energy. With this, let's move on to the next question. The next question is a practice question for mains. The question reads as, the importance of Jallianwala Bagh massacre lies in what preceded it and in what followed. Justify. Now, the answer for this question has already been discussed in today's analysis in the first news item. When we ask what preceded it, it means the various events which happened before the massacre that led to the massacre. When we say what followed, we mean the aftermath, which we have discussed in detail in today's analysis. You may incorporate those points and justify the given statement. The question reads as, discuss the issues and challenges in fighting fake news spreading through social media platforms at the time of elections. Now, herein we can discuss the existing legal provision, section 126 of Representation of People's Act 1951, and about the issues with regulating social media platforms and the right to campaign, and the issues related to right to freedom of expression and right to campaign in social media, various social media platforms really following up or living up to the commitments given in the voluntary code of ethics. These things you can discuss, and you can say that misinformation is a threat to free and fair elections, and this fake news may definitely influence the voting pattern and voters' choices. These are some of the issues that you could bring in from today's analysis to write an answer for this question. With this, let's move on to our next question. What is ASAT? How will it affect the global space governance? The first part is a direct question. For this, you are asked to write in brief about anti-satellite missiles in general. For the second part, you need to speak about the global space governance that includes the Outer Space Treaty. Mention some of the provisions to highlight the current governance. Then mention about how anti-satellite missiles will increase weaponization in space. At the end, you may give some suggestions in a brief nutshell about how to improve the space governance and conclude your answer. With this, we come to the end of today's session.